Hello, ladies and gentlemen, up there in YouTube land, Yahweh here. As always, I want to thank my cousin Vincenzo for posting these for me. I record the audio from various locations where I'm at the time around the world and send them to Vince, who does what he does and puts them up on YouTube for me. The group I'm with, we were in North Korea. We left there a couple of days ago. Made our way out of the mountains down to a port city, got on a boat, sailed south through the South China Sea, along the west end of the Sulu Sea, down into the Java Sea to Indonesia. We are heading down to see what we can do in regards to Mount Merapi. The volcanoes in Indonesia, as everybody knows from history, can have catastrophic eruptions from time to time that have global impact on both the climate patterns of the world as well as the actual physical makeup of the atmosphere. Received a lot of questions from the last video in North Korea. The North Koreans at the end of the day decided to give us the quote-unquote weapon that they had received from the Iranians. The questions I'm getting, a lot of them are, tell us the name of the weapon and what does it do. The name of the weapon, I don't know how to translate it. It would sound like gobbledygook. It's not intentionally designed to be a weapon. The original intent of this device is it uses a very strong localized power source to tear a little hole in the space-time continuum. For lack of a better explanation, it is a kind of operates on a certain frequency. There is a receiving end, so to speak, in another part of the galaxy. These devices, there were originally 9 of them. They were used to relay information back and forth by myself and my original 8 colleagues. The reason that these are thought to be potentially, you know, weaponized is it's difficult to describe. You can turn the device on and not power it up all the way. What it does is, instead of creating a little tear in the space-time continuum, it generates an electromagnetic pulse that's strong enough that it creates kind of a vortex or a swirl, and it's not localized at that point. It kind of expands out. This can be used to disrupt molecular structure of just about anything, whether it be, you know, vegetable, mineral, or animal. This weapon, the North Koreans, at the end of the day, ladies and gentlemen, I don't know what the average person out there in the world thinks of the average North Korean. To be truthful, I don't know what the average North Korean thinks of the rest of the world, but these people are doing the best within the construct of the society in which they live. There are very few old people in North Korea, is one of the things you notice. A lot of the people there have never known anything else. There are those who do understand there is a world outside their borders. Where I was at, up in the mountains, the group of people were a lot of very interesting artists and kind of a bohemian crowd, so to speak. These people told us legends and myths from ancient Korean times, and some things about a couple of the ancient dynasties in China that were fascinating. And the information, the knowledge still exists in the kind of the underculture in North Korea. But these folks are, if they show promise at a young age, they're culled from the flock and taken to a special school. They're treated very well. They're given better food, better accommodations than other people. And everything in North Korea is, how can it be weaponized? But the people in North Korea don't have any specific bone to pick with the rest of the world. They just want to survive. I guess it's important for me at some point to tell my story. And I know these videos can't be very long. Vince always tells me to keep the recordings 15 minutes or less, and I set a timer today. So I want to tell you, I've been on your planet now for a few thousand years. My name is Yahweh. I am called Yahweh of the Anunnaki, but I am not from Nibiru. I am from a planet near the center of the galaxy. The gravitational forces near the center of the galaxy are very intense. They're much different than they are out here on the edge. And consequently, time is perceived differently by my species, which lends itself particularly well to my field, which is interstellar anthropology. And I went to school on Nibiru, where I studied different cultures throughout our galaxy. My specialty, so to speak, is in religion. I learned a lot in school about the proto-culture going on Earth. I wanted to come and study it firsthand. There were nine of us originally that came here. Each of us were given one of these devices. They're made from stone that's taken from a planet that's very near the event horizon of the black hole at the center of our galaxy. The rock, I guess you'd say, it's the best way to describe it, does produce power. It's not radioactive. It wouldn't show up on a Geiger counter or anything, but it does produce power, and when dialed into a specific frequency, produces a lot of power. That is coupled with some very intricately carved and very ancient wood from a tree, granted, that's probably was a couple of 100,000 equivalent Earth years old when that was taken. There is no digital display. It's not fancy. It doesn't look, like a really cool iPhone or anything. But it was used to communicate back and forth. And I, along with eight others, was sent to Earth. We were each sent to different locations around the planet to integrate ourselves into different cultures. And our purpose was to assist with logical, technological advances. And what I mean by that is that we couldn't say, hey, why don't you invent one of these? But if somebody was on the cusp of inventing a technology that could be deemed beneficial to the rest of mankind, we were instructed to provide the little pieces of information to expedite the process, let's say. Number one went to the Mayans. Another went to the Egyptians. The third was sent to a place that doesn't exist anymore. Four was sent to China. And number five was sent to Machu Picchu. Six was sent up north and never seen again. Seven is who I am. Number eight was sent to Africa, to a city that used to be very important called Timbuktu. I would love to send a recording, Vince, of just explaining a little bit about what Timbuktu was like several hundred years ago. An amazing, amazing place. And number nine was Jesus. Now, I've told people this and been accused of blasphemy, and I can assure you it's anything but. I knew Jesus very well, or who you call Jesus. One of the strongest presences I've ever been in. He literally had, I say this, I'm serious, a magnetic personality. People were drawn to the man because he had this innate ability to listen and tell people things about themselves that they didn't think anyone else knew. Certainly not, as was the case many times, a stranger. We were sent here to assist in the development of the species on this planet. And the reason was simple. The Anunnaki, like the planet Earth, they come here from time to time and collect gold. On a galactic scale, as a reference, gold is readily available on Earth and relatively easy to get to. So Earth was of much value to the folks on Nibiru. And I was, I guess the equivalent would be knighted and given a spot on the team and sent here. About 200 years ago, I lost my device. I was in Russia at the time. The device, I came to the knowledge that it was being held by the Romanovs. I was about to retrieve my device when the February Revolution abolished the crown, and the rest is history. I now do not know exactly where it is, otherwise I would do everything within my power to go back and get it. That's why I went to North Korea. That's why I volunteered to go there, because there was a chance that that one was mine. There's no way to identify said devices. There is no one on the receiving end, so to speak, anymore. The department that we were with that sent us here does not exist anymore on Nibiru at the quote-unquote university. Everybody out there needs to understand that I appreciate the donations that have been given at 5sks.com. I really do. They've allowed me to evade capture and kind of live on the lam for the last little while. But I do not seek fame or fortune or glory. The purpose in me telling you guys this is not to scare you, it's not to entertain you, it's not even to educate you, because I say that because to really explain everything you would need to know, I would have to sit down in front of you, and I wish there were some way that I could do that. I wish that there were some way that I could get up in front of a group of people and explain to everybody firsthand who I am, why I'm here, why I'm coming out with all this right now, with, as I've said before, about 2 years left. Not until the end. 2012, ladies and gentlemen, is not the end of the world. It's just the beginning of a new age. It's a period of transformation we're coming into, one that will be turbulent, that will be at times violent, but the particular skill set and knowledge base that I have will allow me to help a lot of people. And I desperately want to do that. I've got to cut this short, I guess. My timer's going off that I'm running out of YouTube time. I'll try to answer more questions, and I'll try to explain more about what I've seen since I've been on this planet. I've seen, at times, infinite compassion, the depths of humanity, and I've also seen things that are too sick to describe. So, I'm going to sign off now. I'll try not to fall in the volcano. Vince, please give everyone my best and tell them thank you very much for their love and support. Yahweh out.